The first speaker of this session is Professor Dipankar Chatterji. And Professor Chatterji did his graduate and master's degree from this university itself, Jadavpur University, and PhD from Indian Institute of Science in 1973, after which he started his career as a faculty member at the School of Life Sciences, the University of Hyderabad in 1978. This was followed by a stint at Albert Einstein College of Medicine and at Stony Brook University for his postdoctoral research. He was with the Molecular Biophysics Unit of IISc, where he became the chair of the Biology and Genetics Unit till 2005. He is known for his pioneering research on bacterial transcription. He is a recipient of Sri Santi Sarup Bhatnagar Award and he is an elected fellow of all the major Indian science academies. The government of India awarded him the fourth highest civilian honor, that is Padma Shri, in 2016 for his contribution for science and engineering. Professor Chatterji, please.
It's a pleasure to come back to my alma mater, Jadavpur University. I always believe the brightest student from the country comes from Jadavpur only. So which other not so famous places in the city don't like to hear me saying that. But anyway, that is the case. Now, let me see how I handle this here. Now, I wanted to talk about scientific temper. However, Soumitra told me he wants me to talk on ethics. Very difficult subject to speak. That's why I was hesitating. I handled several ethics cases. I handle it from different point of view, for different point angle, faculty, students, everything. And it becomes very irrelevant unless you show some cases. But if I have to show cases, I have to take individuals' names, which I don't want to do in a public audience. As a result of which, I make my talk in a little differently. I'll tell you at the end of my talk why I named it Galileo's Children. And I will tell you what are the major reasons of my selecting this talk. So this talk for next 20-25 minutes will go in three different phases. One, I'll talk about the ethics, raise the issue of the ethics. Then I'll tell you how ethics, I try to look at it differently. I cannot go and tell a student, don't believe in God or believe in God. I cannot go and tell a student, have scientific temper. Tomorrow onwards, after breakfast, you are having scientific temper. It's not possible. Even anybody tells me, I laugh at him. I can only say what we can practice, what I can do to develop scientific temper, how scientific temper and, in my belief, ethics in science, almost synonymous concomitant. It's an arguable point. I would like students to raise this issue at the end. Am I right if I say that? How ethical practice is connected with scientific temper and asking questions in science. We are in the country, I'm telling you, we are sitting on a ticking time bomb on ethical practice. Two issues are burning in the country in every institute. I am sure Jadavpur is no exception. One is something to do with sexual harassment. I'm not touching it. It's a completely unethical practice. I'm not touching now because it's not directly linked with science. Second was non-ethical practice, doing science in a very wrong way. Unethical practices, I listed here something. And I grouped the people, I'm sure it is visible to all of you, in three different classes: undergraduate students, PhD students, postdoctoral fellows, and professors. All come from same cause. All come from same cause: extreme insecurity and pressure. These four things are coming for four different levels. For a student of Jadavpur University or the maximum member of the Breakthrough Society, perhaps, first two are the most important points. Now, I will take it very lightly. Not lightly. I will not tell they are sinners. It happens. Unethical practice people do. Are we responsible for it? Can we get out of it? How can we get out of it? As ex-president philosopher Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan once commented about Valmiki, he said, every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. A young student of 2022 who encounters with unethical practice, how to handle that? Maximum unethical practice I find people do unknowingly. Plagiarism is the most common thing happening among writing scientific reports, and it is rampant in China and India. According to Nature's investigation, the scientific magazine Nature, that one of the Chinese students said, what is wrong? If something is written so beautiful English so well, I cannot write anything better than that, so I copy it up. But please do remember when you do this, when you write your book, notebook, your answer scripts, that when a person writes something very good, it is the labor of his intellect. He worked hard or she worked hard for this. You have no reason to steal it. That is the first comes. Then comes data manipulation. I'll come to this slide later. Data manipulation is, it comes out of laziness. It's not a dishonesty, tremendous dishonesty, but they are not sinners, I won't say. They are probably, they are immature. Data manipulation, we face it all the time. What happens in biology, I know because I'm a biologist, they doctored the film, doctored the picture. Any picture you send, any figure you send, they doctor it. It's called cosmetization of the data or massaging the data. Postdoctoral fellows, they do the same thing. And when professor has a job, what he has to worry? He has to worry for his promotion, for his grant, for his paper, for his awards. Awards is a stupid thing to do. For award, you don't try to do certain so many bad things, but people do that. And we face that every day. Every day, we get cases where people have done all this. Ask the question now. Is it necessary to do, if you are asking the right question, you are a professor. Suppose an experiment failed. Suppose your proposition did not work. Then, why you have to falsify the data? Because please remember one thing. In science, every single wrong experiment will be caught eventually. The basic tenets of science, the basic facts of science is the reproducibility. Today at Jadavpur University, you do an experiment, you find some fantastic results. You do two or three times, every time you get the same result within plus minus a statistical bar. Same results, if somebody in Timbuktu or Alaska do it, will get the same thing. Then only science stays. There are so many papers are written, so many papers, millions of papers are written every year. They have gone into oblivion because many of them are wrong or falsified data. So falsified data never stays in the literature. So you are not a gainer ultimately. You can't gain anything in life by manipulation of the data. Plagiarism will be caught by any Google search. Every journal now has a very strict rules. I get papers to review with a red flag that this is plagiarized. In the sense, they have 9 words, consecutively same sentence comes, they put a red flag. That means it's taken from these and these papers. So, and there are papers from this city also. Many papers. So it's very shameful, and it happens. No journal take those papers because they have before reviewing, they have a cross-check. So these are coming from insecurity. Why insecurity? Because you have tremendous pressure to have a PhD within 5 years, to get a job. But if you look at all the PhDs or postdocs, 5% get a promotion, tenured job. Rest 95% do not get it. I think I have no clear data, the people who are falsifying the data, they are going into that 95%. The 5% who make it to a good position, they are coming out of this falsification. They're doing something, even don't count your several matrices, these are all wrong, everybody knows. Honest effort, getting into the lab in the morning, or going into the department, do something, write some calculations, theoreticians. At the end of the day, if it remains fine, then you are happy. But this is very easy to tell, but it's difficult to practice, but I request you to practice it. At the end of my talk, I'll come back to this slide again and show you, connect it with my lecture title today. But now I'll deviate a little bit and show you, I'll tell you how unethical practice are connected, intermingled with temper of scientific temper. Scientific temper we have talked about a lot. Two things unethical practice connected with your fear of God, your fear of self. Unethical practice who are practicing, they are more very fearful. I'll make this point, anybody can challenge me, counter me. Those who are very honest in the lab and go and sleep or days work, numerous literature stories have been written. If a farmer who would put honest effort in the lab, in the farm, do very good work, they go and sleep a very nice. In Hindi, mein bolte hai, chain ki neend jati hai. So that is the whole thing, that whether you can sleep without any remorse, that comes to your scientific temper, that whether I am doing the right thing, yes, I'm doing that. If you are not, then you try to find a save in the name of God. I want to show you here a very great man, Jacques Monod, who got Nobel Prize. He was a starving individual. He fought against Hitler in the night in France, along with a great philosopher, existentialist philosopher, Albert Camus. And in the night, he was fighting against occupied France by Hitler. And daytime, he was doing research. He was doing how bacteria grow under mixture of sugars. His PhD project, postdoc project, everything. New paradigm, got Nobel Prize. He's a brilliant man. I follow him. I like him. You don't have to like him if I say that. He wrote a book called Essays on the Natural Philosophy. He said, chance and necessity is a prime force for science. Chance and necessity means somebody asked the question in the previous speaker, why you are questioning the luck, like fortune, whatever you say. Chance is one of them. I cannot define by science, by any kind of definition, scientific definition, this is chance. Chance happens, it happens every moment in our life. Our decision, if our mind is right, if we are in the right environment, if our mind is prepared, we take the chance and go to the next step. But he said, nature has no goal. Nothing is predestined in life. You do not need finger stones. Nothing is predestined. Everything happens as you do proceed from day to day. So therefore, it is nothing predestined. Science is, as the natural philosophy talks about it. Sorry. Principle of vaccination was discovered accidentally. It happens to a very prepared mind. The light is very less here anyway. Sorry. Discovery of penicillin was also a chance. But remember, these all chances happen to a prepared mind. They didn't have to falsify the data for that. It happened, it worked. But there are some stories in the literature which we cannot really say anything against them. And there's a part of joke, people say success is talent plus luck and great success is little more talent, a lot of luck. We do not, he's a famous economist, he said that. So with that mind, keeping in mind, we can say, are we providing enough chance, enough, our infrastructure of the government, our academic environment, to the all students of Jadavpur University, say, take it as an example, are we giving them enough pathways to take the right step, do the right ethical science, and develop their career? Moment we fail, we have no right to ask them, why you are failing, don't do any unethical practice. Unethical practice when comes, when you want to outsmart other person by gaining something at the expense of others, in spite of being poor in academically. And that is happening all the time. So we should maximize the chance because it's a necessity, and that is the part of chance and necessity. In the first speaker today morning, talked about scientific temper. It was a Nehruvian concept to start with in this country. Allahabad universities, he convocation address, he mentioned that science can only solve the problem of hunger and poverty. It's a brilliant statement. And we started in the right earnest our scientific endeavor and the scientific path. He was a close friend of Einstein and many other scientists. And Nehru was strong committed to promotion of science in India. Similarly, very illustrious son of this country, C.V. Raman, said, there is only one solution for India's economic problem, and that is science, more science and still more science. In this background, practicing science, we should have the proper chance, proper environment. But please, I request to think over it, that even if you find somebody is gaining something by unethical practice, allow time. Don't jump. I get this reasoning so much. When I cornered a student for unethical practice, he said, Mr. A or Mr. X in that institute or this lab, their papers are wrong because they have something falsified the data. If they can accept it, go ahead in their life. Why I can't? They'll be caught. I can guarantee you they'll be caught. Anybody who unethical practice will be caught. So the question doesn't arise. Nobody can pursue further. So if you have a proper scientific temper, your unethical practice will go. So all the time I'm going back. I don't know why. So I said this unethical practice, therefore, these are the paradigm on which unethical practice stand. We can counter them only by scientific mind, scientific temperament, scientific temper, and right practice. And we are in the right country to do that. India is a very poor country, extremely poor country in world standard, who are practicing very good science. Anybody who tells me that India has not produced a Nobel Prize after C.V. Raman, or says that India, I always answer them, the kind of environment our people are, students are, amount of money government of India is spending day to day, what we are doing is much better than many other countries. It's true. So there is nothing to be shy about it. We are doing very good science, so we should go on doing that. But please do that with ethical practice, because India already has a bad reason, bad name, because of these reasons I show here, data manipulation and things like that, cosmetization data. However, why I am little less toxic about cosmetization of the data or data manipulation, I thought over it a lot. I am very much sympathetic to the students, undergraduate students, when they plagiarize their lab reports or their report of data sheet or assignments, because I teach undergraduate for 5 years in our ISC undergraduate students. Because they are very clean minds, but probably they're lazy, they're tired, whatever. They think it's a lot of pressure to have so much assignments. So you have to talk with them all the time. You have to monitor them. But don't punish them too much to the professors. Allow them some time. If a PhD student doing it, change the project, but tell them what is wrong, because that work will not see the light of the day ever in life. It will never be cited, because nobody will cite it. When anybody try to reproduce it, it will come down. You will not be able to do so. Promotion is a thing which is almost everybody gets. Grant is getting difficult. Paper writing, it will be caught. Awards, we can't help it. Some people will get award with wrong data eventually, so you have to live with it. But they will also be caught. History shows very simple, very interesting paradigm. Science, scientific research. Classic case is Galileo. This is taken from Nature. That's why I named it Galileo's Children. 2 weeks back it came. Galileo later livingly tried to dodge the Inquisition. Very sad story. Have we punished Galileo? We have not. Famous scientist Galileo, if you read his books, you will see, to avoid Inquisition from the church, pressure on church, he doctored his letter. This article talks about it. He doctored his letter and he kept the letter in such, and he was a very unhappy man because he did it as a great man. He had started drinking, very sick after because of tremendous drinking. His wife, his daughter wrote the book, Galileo's Daughter. There's a famous book. I took it from there. And he was an unhappy man because the letter is not his mind. He knew that earth is revolving around. But he has to accept the charge verdict and alter it a little bit. Now, Roman Catholic Church comes out and says, I'm sorry you did mistake. But finally, time shows, but where is Galileo? But he faced this problem. So a great scientist, great man, also did this kind of things. It is called cosmetization of data, data manipulation. And the same article tells, now Clear doctored his original letter himself to make the language less aggressive as soon as he realized the trouble heading his way. This suggests that the editing was not the malign work of theologian trying to make a strong case against him, as he had been assumed by the 19th century scholar Favaro, with the 20th volume work of Galileo Galilei. They tried to save him. This came in 27 September issue of Nature. So much so, I was so surprised. Out of nothing, I wanted to take out some classical experiments, take it as a joke, but this happens. Classical experiments done in the literature. My physicist friend can correct me, but I want to be honest to the students. Some of the students will come and tell me that you have given me so much gain about ethics, originality, and all this discipline, practice, everything. But what happened to other people who do this? Very famous people do this. So I did a Google search. In my mind, one of the classical scientific experiments was Millikan oil drop experiment, which was redone in a more sophisticated way, and fractional charge was found, which gave the discovery of quarks. In that book, they say that Millikan also got several charges which are not same as the real experiment. His smartness was the data he reported is the right data. But there are several data came, and that's how the scientists handle. You get data which is wrong. It was not included in the statistical analysis of the charge distribution, as a result of which Google did not, you can do it, Wikipedia or Google, you'll find it, Millikan oil drop experiment. He got, they call cosmetization of such data, that he removed certain data which are not matching with the electronic charge, which he think was right. So in life, you will face several such problems in life, which your experiments you find not agreeing. You have to analyze, you have to talk with your supervisor, talk with your professor, and find out whether the data is right, whether it is possible to interpret the data and take the right data in your hand. Second point is you have to think that this only comes from good scientific temper. I am not bringing God, no God, nothing in this. Scientific temper is the first important scientific temper in life, is ethical practice. I am honest to myself, I am honest with my data. At the end of the day, I can go to sleep in a peaceful mind. I have not done anything wrong. Failed experiment, fine. Let me continue with that. Maybe do 1 or 2 year more PhD. But what I report should be the right data. Anybody in Alaska can report it, the same thing. Reproducibility is the basic essence of science, and you should survive on that principle. Thank you very much.